Good afternoon. Welcome to our faith community of Sacred Heart. My name is Mary Kay Head. The feast of the baptism of the Lord marks the end of the Christmas season. We have celebrated Jesus' birth and coming of age, and now we will turn our focus to his public ministry. If you have a cell phone, we ask that you please make sure that it is muted or in the off position during Mass. We have been asked at this Mass to pray for the eternal peace of Luke Corwin. And we wish to thank you for continuing to observe social distancing, wearing your face covering throughout Mass, and continuing the practice of walking around to the back of the church to come up the center aisle to receive communion if you are seated in the side aisle pews. And at this time, we ask that you please stand and join in singing the opening hymn, Baptized in Water.
Thank you. reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without paying and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread? Your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully. Listen, that you may have life. I will renew you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David. As I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander of nations, so shall you summon a nation you knew not, and nations that knew you not shall run to you, because of the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Come on.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is begotten by God, and everyone who loves the Father loves also the one begotten by him. In this way, we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world. And the victory that conquers the world is our faith. Who indeed is the victor over the world, but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came through water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water alone, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one who testifies, and the Spirit is truth. So there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and the three are of one accord. If we accept human testimony, the testimony of God is surely greater. Now the testimony of God is this, that he has testified on behalf of his Son. The word of the Lord.
According to Mark. This is what he proclaimed, one mightier than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop and loosen the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. It happened in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized in the Jordan by John. On coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit, like a dove, descending upon him. And a voice came from the heavens, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord. When I was in college many years ago, I had a job at a pizza place, Domino's Pizza, actually here in town in Columbia, Missouri, on Town Drive, for those of you who are familiar. So anyway, I was a delivery boy, you know, I used to bring the pizzas to people, and I tell you, that job, I got a lot of homilies out of that job, and just in general, a lot of stories out of that job. And I was telling some of the servers before Mass on there, some of the stories I can't really repeat in public. And you're probably thinking, oh, Father, please tell those stories, the ones that you can't say in public. But the thing that really struck me about that job, I've had a number of jobs in my life, and I was in college and before college and all that, and a lot of different bosses. And the thing that really struck me about the job at that pizza place was our boss. He was a wonderful boss because he didn't just sit back in a chair and like dictate to us what to do and then complain, you know, if we didn't do it. He actually got right in there and worked with us. Now, he was very decisive. He was a good boss because he was very decisive. He was very clear about his expectations, you know, what he wanted for that place and what he wanted us to do. Very clear and decisive, but very pleasant about it. But he literally rolled up his sleeves and actually worked right alongside us. And he has no idea, I'm sure. I haven't seen that man in years and years. But he would have no idea, first of all, he'd wind up in a homily. But certainly, secondly, he would never have any idea that he really made that impression on me, because just such a pleasant guy, and that was a very, very good boss. And really, those are the qualities not only of a good boss, but really of good leaders, if you think about it. Because, you know, good leaders don't just dictate from on high and tell everybody else what they should do. They actually, as this man was, very decisive, very clear about what needs to be done, and then they will lead by example. Or not lead by example walking ahead of you, they will actually walk alongside you, which that boss did. Today, as you know, we celebrate the feast of the baptism of the Lord. And, you know, of course, people wonder, well, why was the Lord baptized? What was the deal there? As you know, you're a good Catholic, since we have some good Christians among us too, maybe not Catholic, you know that, baptism does a couple things. Of course, it's a sacrament of initiation. It brings us into the church. But it also wipes away the stain of original sin that all of us have. And those are the things that baptism does for us. Especially the part about the original sin. You know, of course, we ask, well, why would Jesus have to be baptized? You know, he had no original sin. He had no sin at all, quite the opposite. Why would he have to be baptized? Well, basically, you know, he did not have to even come into our world. He could have dictated from on high, you know, what he wanted us to do. He could have told us what his expectations are for us, and really told us those things from on high, from heaven, and perhaps not wanted to dirty himself, didn't want to soil himself or roll up his sleeves. But he did just the opposite. You know, as we know, of course, our manger reminds us he came here among us and was born in poverty. You know, he got down in the dirt with us. He rolled up his sleeves, and he wanted to be with us. And so it was with his baptism that he did not have to be baptized to rid himself of original sin, or any sin for that matter. But he wanted to give us a map, you know, and lead us by example, and literally walk alongside us in the entire journey of our Christian life. We know that our Christian life, of course, begins with baptism, and Jesus' ministry began with his baptism. In a sense, he was commissioned. You know, we have the presence of the Trinity all together there. Jesus, of course, and God the Father and the Holy Spirit. And then God the Father, in a sense, was kind of commissioning him on his journey, on his mission. And he said, I'm well pleased in you. And it was the beginning of his ministry. And we know, of course, in his ministry that he literally got in the dirt, rolled up his sleeves, and walked right alongside us, and showed us, start to finish, you know, how we are to live as Christians. The baptism itself, not only Jesus, but really everyone who's baptized, very beautiful. There's the reality of the sacrament, but very, very beautiful symbolism in it, because, you know, it really recalls the Israelites as they were led out of captivity to freedom through the sea, through the Red Sea, the parting of the sea. And it recalls that, even before that, of course, with Noah, and as the earth was flooded because of its sin and purified with those waters, of course, we have a dove coming back, reminding of Noah that there was dry land, really leading them out of sin. So very, very beautiful symbolism in this with the water and the dove. So what does this mean for us? Well, you know, for those, most of us here, I'm sure, are baptized. And it really is our entrance into the church, into our faith. But also is, in a sense, a commissioning for us as well. You know, for us, even though most of us are infants and we don't realize it, of course, but nonetheless, we are commissioned, you know, by God to really embark on this beautiful journey of this life. And we are called. We are called to be missionaries, really to work in our vocation, whatever that is, in our life, and embark on our mission in our ministry as well. Although, for most of us, you know, our baptism happened a long time ago, we can still really recall it with great fondness, And, you know, most of us probably, I don't know, some of you maybe know, like, the date of your baptism. God forgive me, I forgot mine. So this is a public confession in front of everybody. But, you know, I've heard it said that it's really kind of a neat thing. You really kind of looked it up. You see, you know, when, well, I know where I was baptized, but, you know, when was I baptized? What was the date of my baptism? And kind of recall it in our own lives, which is really a beautiful thing to do, you know, and to remind ourselves, what does our baptism mean? Well, just like Jesus, as he walked with us and we're called to walk with him, in a sense, it's the beginning of our ministry and the beginning of our mission here on earth. What a beautiful thing. You know, what a beautiful thing for us to recall. So let us pray that we beautifully and dutifully accept our mission and our ministry as Jesus began his with his baptism. And let us accept that as a beautiful, not only responsibility, but what a beautiful opportunity for us to embark on our mission and our ministry. And let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ and thank him, you know, for coming among us and living among us and having the humility to be born among us, to be baptized also as we are. And let us pray to the Lord that we really accept our ministry, our mission, and let us constantly ask the Lord, you know, where he wants to send us, what he wants us to do, and let us renew our own baptism in that sense, and renew our opportunity in our ministry in this life.
Response to our intercessions is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For God's holy church, may it continue Jesus' ministry by constantly doing good works and offering healing to those oppressed in body, mind, and spirit. We pray,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our church leaders, that they might be voices of justice for those neglected and oppressed in the world. We pray,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For places in the world infected by the scourge of slavery, exploitation, and human trafficking, may God raise up advocates to effect change. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us at Sacred Heart Parish, that we will live out our baptismal calling to live in justice and unity. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, that the Lord will bless them with healing and peace. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, may they be given the life promised to those born again of water and the Spirit. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For these prayers and all the prayers we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and living God, bring salvation to all who desire the ones who perish in the prayers of your people.
Yeah.
Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all.
Help will be needed this Sunday to take down the Christmas decorations. This will be happening Sunday afternoon at 2:30 in the afternoon. If you are able to come and help, it would really be appreciated because many of the things that we use to decorate are stored on the top floor of the education building. So it helps to have a lot of young people and strong people that can help do this. January can be especially lonely time for some, due to the cold or due to sickness, or in particular this year, due to the avoidance of the possible COVID contact. We encourage you to reach out to others with phone calls or sending cards or notes. Showing support to others could be vital to our community. Room at the Inn, the overnight shelter for the homeless in our community, is up and running. Volunteers are always needed. Many additional systems are in place this year to keep volunteers safe and healthy. Please read the details online at Room at the Inn, Como. Thank you.